So here with Sarah Booker Lewis, a local democracy reporter, backed by a popular demand again, and lots going on, isn't there, Sarah, local council. We've got the Labour Party conference for one thing, and then freedom of information as well, which I think was something that Tony Blair brought in actually back when Labour were in power. And for local council level, it's been quite useful, hasn't it? Freedom of information. There's a bit of a backlog as well with the council answering freedom of information requests.
Yes. Now, this is a report going towards the Audit and Standards Committee this week. It was an issue raised by Anne Meadows. As you say, freedom of information is very useful. It's great for picking up a lot of data. And there are currently 186 overdue cases in Brighton and Hove. Councils are supposed to respond to requests within 20 days. And anyone can put an FOI forward. And in Brighton and Hove, the majority are by organisations and individuals, and they're experiencing very frustrating, lengthy delays. Now, campaigners who work with Rise, they have been very vocal in complaining about the lack of responses to the various requests they put forward when the charity lost its contract. And councillors have supported them and pushed senior management, and they've got some responses, but not all of them. So the current backlog is sort of pandemic related, but not quite. The number of requests has reduced. It's the low at its lowest level since 2016, but we've got this 168. And last year, more than half, 64%, were not completed within the 20-day time limit. And that's down from 70% the year before, which is still very low compared with a lot of other councils. And of this overspill, the vast majority have been going on for more than 40 days. And the report going before councillors this week, it says there's a long-term vacancy in the team, which is causing delays, but also it's very critical of the management of the FOI team as well, the poor quality of data, duplication, silo working, where people don't look outside their box, or maybe others don't really want to respond to the request. So that is, it is quite a big issue. So most of the applications in Brighton and Hove are actually from businesses or unknown, but the media is 11%. And I know I've got two outstanding requests, one of them for nearly a year. And it's a bit of a pointless effort, that one, but there we go.
Yeah. Who's putting them in? I mean, we've put in one or two as well. I know that the local media have as well. Do the public tend to do freedom of information requests, you know, or you might not know?
Well, yeah, there's a nice pie chart. I love a pie chart. 20%, 7% of the applications are unknown, but about 9 to 10% are actually residents. Right. And I do look through the list sometimes, and you can see a lot of people who are familiar with the process, who want information, they do put requests in. It is open to everybody.
It is, which is good. Yeah, and that's a good idea. And I know some interesting information has come out as a result of freedom of information requests. Obviously, we've had the COVID pandemic, so they'll be using that as a reason, probably a legitimate reason, but we're kind of moving beyond that now. So you should be getting your response soon, I would have thought.
I've been told my November one from last year is coming in November, but we'll wait and see.
Yeah.
One from April. I know, I mean, the other one from April, I'm after some specific data about public engagement with the council during the COVID period in comparison with other times. And I do know the councillors have this information, so the information is there, just someone is resisting passing it on to me.
Yeah, interesting. Okay, moving on to the strategic risks coming up from the Audit and Standards Committee and the carbon neutral programme. Tell us a bit about that.
Well, the council aims to be carbon neutral by 2030, yeah. But in the strategic risks, this has a red rating on the risk register. It's something they're concerned about, they're not going to be able to achieve. Now, there are a wide variety of concerns here in Brighton and Hove, from rising sea levels impacting on us, flooding, yeah, losing streets. There's also the potential for water shortages due to drought and also damaged crops. We have agriculture in the north of the city, because the council owns 12,000 acres of the downs and farmland. And they're working with the national park to protect the water supply that comes through the rain and is stored in the chalk. So that's why when you turn your tap on sometimes, it's all a bit chalky because that's where our water comes from. And they're trying to preserve that, look after that. They're also working with the Environment Agency to protect the coast from erosion because we've got longshore drift. That's why shore and beach exists, where it all shifts along. So we have our sea defences to protect the beach and keep it where it is. But one of the issues that is making this a red rating is how effective can the council be when some of the issues that we're facing in terms of climate and flooding can really only be dealt with on a national and an international level because we're looking at acidification of the oceans and all that sort of thing. But in the report that's going towards councillors, it does say, you know, we can do our bit. We are cogs in the greater machine and all the little cogs added together do create something. So one of the things that is raised is the issue of recycling. We're still at 29% of waste recycled. And a lot of this is due to contamination. So the council is moving forward with looking at recycling pots and tubs and trays. I know I see it in the recycling boxes in my area. People that just put their yogurt pots, their butter tubs and all that sort of thing in the recycling. It contaminates it and that lot ends up in the incinerator, which is what we don't want. So we need to, as in the whole lot, the cardboard, the plastic bottle, all the recyclables end up being burned as well. So I think that there needs to be a lot of a harder message going across about what people can recycle.
Yeah, it's got so confusing. It's almost, I guess some of that is the council's responsibility. I've had this conversation with Councillor Hannah Clare, deputy leader as well. I mean, they're stuck with this Veolia contract, of course, aren't they, the council, for the next few years, which I think the previous Labour administration tied the council into. So there's not so much that they can do, but it's difficult. I mean, to have a Green Party council and a very low recycling rate is an interesting kind of point, isn't it, about the council? And of course, the communal bins don't help either, do they?
No, I think it is a bit of an embarrassment for them, really, that the recycling is so appalling. And unfortunately, a lot of it, as you say, yes, there is this contract which restricts. But it's just getting the message out because I know I've got a new bunch of students moved in two doors down and I gave them a list of things they can recycle. Just because, you know, they're a nice bunch of young lads and they're quite keen. And they were like, oh, no pots. No, you can't do the pots. And people can do it. And that's why they get confused. And I know I've seen in community groups people saying, I've just moved into Five Ways. I haven't got a food caddy. How do we do our food recycling? And they just find it weird that we don't have it. But it is coming. It is coming in the next couple of years. So, yes, this contract was something like a 25-year contract. That's a very long time to stick when things change. It develops. Refuse and recycling is a movable feast. So we all need to do a better job, really.
Yeah. What about the seafront regeneration and housing? That came up at the same committee, didn't it? And you all did it.
It's coming up. Yeah. It's coming up, yes. So the seafront, that has an amber rating on the risk register. Now, of course, the seafront is the big driver of our tourism industry. And COVID particularly has really underlined how important tourism is in terms of jobs and the economy. Lots of small businesses, our hospitality industry. Things are getting better. People are coming back. But one of the big pushes, of course, is to make our economy year round because there's always so much of a focus, particularly in May. It's almost mental. You can't move for a festival or an event, but shifting things so that there are more winter and autumn and spring events. But and we've got millions of people that visit the seafront. So Madeira Terraces, critical point. I think pretty much everyone in the city is concerned because it does look terrible, all that scaffolding, and you know that they're deteriorating before our eyes. And the council has put millions into the terraces so far. And the restoration is going to start. So even though this is amber, 30 of the arches, it is going to start in the next few months. So that is something to be pleased about. It's not everything. I mean, gosh, doing the whole thing is going to cost even more millions.
Yeah.
But we need to start on those first 30. And work, I think a lot of people have seen on the seafront down at Blackrock, the work's underway on the seawall. I've seen people saying, why are they shifting the beach across?
Yeah.
Build the seawall and shift it all around. And one of the advantages of our shingle beach is it's a lot easier to shift. You've got these horrible, great, difficult to access for people because of the huge banks of shingle, but at least you can shift it around. So there's going to be improvements in the reading room, the temple. We're going to see a pump track there, which will probably prove quite popular as we had BMX success at the recent Olympics. So that's the sort of thing where the young people can get on their BMXs and go around. So that's coming up. And also, we've currently got the Kingsway to the Sea consultation going on, looking at improving the western end, Hove seafront.
Okay. Yeah. All right, second half then, we will be talking to a lot more about Sarah Buckley about local issues. Do you understand? So back here with Sarah Booker Lewis, local democracy reporter, and we are going back through some local issues that are coming up. Hannington's Lane, O'Donnell's Moonshine. I did hear a bit about this. Just remind us about what O'Donnell's Moonshine is and the fact that that's coming to Hannington's Lane, which is looking pretty nice still, isn't it, Hannington's Lane? It's a really nice shopping area, to be fair. They've done a good job.
It is really pretty.
It is, yeah.
So O'Donnell's Moonshine, it's a German company. They bottle in Germany and they have a shop in Manchester. So what they're looking to do is set up a pop-up shop. They want to set it up now in September. Well, they wanted to set it up in September, but I think they're going to have to wait until October now. It's going to be at 5 Hannington's Lane if they get a license. Now, that site was used by Brazen Wine just for a short period in August and September, again, as a pop-up, as a specialist company. Now, Brazen came, they came to a deal with the police about their timings and what they would have in there and so on. Now, O'Donnell's, they make flavoured liqueurs. It's a multiple flavours, sort of like burnt apple and all that sort of thing, or burnt toffee apple maybe. And when they applied, they just put in an application, but they didn't read the licensing policy. So the Lanes, that's in the city centre. And the council's policy is for no new off licences at all in the city centre. So what they're working on, the police have also objected because the city centre, they don't want more alcohol go hitting the streets. So they've already agreed that they're going to install CCTV. But what they need to argue is that they have exceptional circumstances to allow them to sell retail alcohol in that area. So what we're looking at, they're not going to have anything refrigerated because that's something that the police and the council don't want, is an off-license selling refrigerated beers and wine. They're just going to be selling this specialist product. It comes in a mason jar. So the owners have said it's not the sort of thing that you buy. They're about 30 or 40 quid a jar. You don't open it up and just start sipping it. It's the same as you don't see people walking along the street swigging a bottle of Tia Maria, although it's not quite the same thing. But, you know, yeah. It's a similar sort. It comes into that liqueur umbrella.
Yeah.
So what they've got to do is put their case to the council this week and say, right, we have exceptional circumstances. Please let us sell our fancy liqueurs in a jar from Hannington's Lane.
Yeah, I can imagine if it's anything to go by from the old moonshine, it's going to be, the alcohol volume is going to be astronomical as well.
They have already said they won't sell their really, really strong one.
Okay.
It is all quite strong stuff. I mean, they have one that's like something like 100% proof.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Smell it and you pass out. But they've already admitted that if they will not sell that here in Central Brighton. So that again is sort of coming to a compromise.
Good news. Okay. So what about parking permits? This is a big issue. We were just discussing off air about, I heard reports, a colleague of mine was saying that people park up in Lancing car parks, £1.90 apparently all day at the weekends, and getting a number 700 bus into the town. It's not so related to parking permits, but parking is an issue, isn't it, in the city? Absolutely no doubt.
Yes. Now, this This is something I've seen burning away in the community groups. I know Councillor Nemeth has spoken on the radio about issues that people have come to him with, and I've been trying to get people to talk to me about the problems they're having with their parking permits. So the council changed its system. They now have this one account, and you do your council tax, your parking permit, everything through the one account on the council website. But something is going wrong and it's not linking together. Now, Councillor Nemeth has brought this up at the Environment, Transport and Sustainability, ETS. And one of his key issues where he's been talking to people is because it's all online, so particularly some of the older population are struggling with it, or people that just aren't very into IT. It requires uploading documents and all sorts. And although the council has said, well, you know, the officers can help, people are not in the office. The town hall is still not open. There was something quite comforting about going to the town hall. And I think every time I tried to do it, I'd always miss something and they would send me off and I'd get my piece of paper and come back and talk to a human being with a face who would sort of stamp the right thing, give you your permit, there you are, off you go. Now, thankfully, I got my new permit before this all came in, but my husband is still waiting 2 weeks on after his money's gone out of the account. So hopefully his permit will turn up by Friday or he'll get a parking ticket. People are getting parking tickets. The council has their money, but they don't have their permit and they're getting parking tickets. Now, earlier in the summer, the council did say, oh, well, you know, we'll give a little period of grace and leeway. But it's getting quite bad now. And the assistant director for transport, he said he is working on it every day now because it is such a big problem. And the chief executive, Jeff Raw, he's on it as well. So when Jeff Raw's involved, you know that there's a bit of a problem.
Yeah. And I can imagine that if you get a parking ticket, you'll get it reimbursed, refunded. But then it's a hassle of then, you know, on top of everything else, you know, even getting petrol for your car nowadays, you've got to then kind of go through the administrative system to kind of get a refund. It's just hassle that you can do without.
Yeah, it is hassle. And of course, some people have been, they've had a couple of parking tickets done and now they're getting back like, no, you've had a couple done. You should have sorted this by now. I was like, no, you should have sorted this by now. But I have now got some people who are willing to talk to me and fingers crossed, I will be able to sort of take it further and see what else I can find out.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Interesting. Bins are a big issue, aren't they? Bins and weeds are a big issue at the moment. Bristol Estate, I do go around there quite often on a 37 bus, so bins are overflowing over there. It's an issue. It seems to be sporadic. I know that some areas in Hove, particularly the areas that don't have communal bins, are struggling with getting their bins picked up, waiting 3 or 4 weeks sometimes. I know there's been a bin strike on the horizon, but COVID has kind of restricted kind of the amount of people that can work on the refuse lorries as well.
Yeah, I mean, City Clean has been hit really hard with COVID. They've had a lot of people self-isolating, a lot of people off sick as well, because they've worked all the way through and they do work closely together. But this all predates COVID. The City Clean needs modernisation. The fleet is out of date. It doesn't have a computer system. And they're trying to bring things forward. And then as they try and move forward, you've got COVID hits. There's the fire that happened a couple of years ago. It just sets everything back. You know, it's almost like they take one step forward and then 20 steps back. But particularly with the Bristol Estate, there is a particular area of the Bristol Estate, Bowing Way, where they have had ongoing problems for years. And most recently in the summer, there was the case of a block Pippin where their bins weren't collected and they ended up with a fly infestation. And they found out that they hadn't been told they were supposed to be emptying their bins at a new bin store, because a single bin store was built between two blocks of flats. Everyone in the road thought it was just for the two blocks of flats, but it turns out that is actually supposed to be for everyone. You've got five blocks of flats feeding into one bin store. Now, what I've established is there should have been two bin stores built, but there wasn't enough money, so they have one. And there's only enough money to collect it all once a week. So basically, the bins get emptied. And then by the time they're ready to collect again, the place is just one mass of black bags because all the bins are full and everyone's just chucking their rubbish on it. And it's really a bad situation for those people. Now, Nancy Platts, she is one of their councillors. She's been dealing with it. And I could see on her face last week, it's not just this area. Every single councillor in this city is just sick of the bins. In the 3 years I've been local democracy reporter, I think I've spoken to a councillor about bins every week. And she just went off on one last week. She had a huge rant. You know, what? She was the leader of the council. And she said, you know, I understand that there are issues, but we're not getting to the bottom of it. And in the end, she said, what do they want? More money? Just pay them more. Because, I mean, really, who wants to be a bin man? It's not the greatest job in the world, but it's one of the most important.
It's very important. There is an issue. Now, I have to say, there's not so much of an issue with some of these communal bins. They do seem to be, where I am on Eastern Road, they do seem to get, I mean, I think we get someone picking them up every day even. So it's really odd that we get a very good service emptied every single day, whereas up the road in Bristol Estate, they don't get the same service. So what is going on there? It doesn't make any sense.
The communal street bin service, they go out at 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock in the morning. Exactly. They're among the very early starters. And yes, they are collected every day because if you leave it, I think we've seen what happens when they do get left. It just attracts fly tipping and you've got a lot of houses going into one single bin. It needs to be cleared. Whereas the estates, the blocks of flats, they're sort of thought of as almost like one home, but with lots of bins. So that's why they're dealt with at once. But really, the situation should be similar to the communal bins.
Yeah. Okay. And we're going to leave it there. That's Sarah Booker-Lewis, local democracy reporter. We'll catch up again next week, Sarah. Thanks a lot.